Welcome to CNBC-TV18.com Industry Knowledge Exchange Conclave powered by SAP. Now we know that enterprises today are facing pressure to reduce costs to find creative and efficient ways to optimize production in a post-pandemic world. One of the key enablers to achieve this big feat is procurement. The onus of establishing economic and business growth in enterprises lies with procurement sectors and to ensure that company today is equipped with agile functions in a dynamic environment. Today, I'm joined by an esteemed panel of industry leaders who are going to tell us how they're bringing this change in their respective industries to enhance organizational procurement and elevate production with business performances. Joining Sharad Gargia, the Group Chief Commercial Officer at Vedanta Limited, Mr. Naveen Alawat, the Chief of Procurement at JSPL, Mr. Rajesh Uppal, CIO, Maruti Suzuki Limited, Mr. Mansoor Akhtar, the Head of Indirect Procurement South Asia at Reckitt Benckiser, and Mr. Ashwini Narang, VP, Intelligence Spend Crew at SAP. Gentlemen, a warm welcome to you today. Rajesh, historically, streamlining procurement processes was done to bring down costs. But now we know it's increasingly used as a value enabler. Can you tell us how procurement is making the change from being a cost saver to a key value enabler?
Very clearly, the whole landscape of procurement is changing. One very, very important element I personally feel is the whole ability to manage the procurement the way you do in your day-to-day life. You know, today with the, you know, Amazon kind of buying or the e-commerce kind of buying all of people do at their homes, I think everybody want to have that kind of experience in their working place also, where you can compare, you know, products, you can look at which value, what product, what value, and also have a very smooth experience of doing the procurement. Now, traditionally, you know, IT the automated organization was using the traditional way of buying things around, you know, to do that. Now, you need a lot of automation to really manage that process, which is a more experience-based and also create best possible value into that. Now, that's a big change which is happening in the industry today, and it has been going on for quite some time now. So, we are looking at the whole process of procurement from point of view of the way you give experience to both the buyer and the suppliers. Also, the experience of getting right value out of the buying, you have all the information available to you for taking right decision about buying. And also, the whole process is governed in a best possible way. Now, that's the big change which I think industry are adopting and industry like us are adopting. And we are looking forward to get that process adopted by each one of the departments of the organization to ensure that you get a maximum possible value from the investment you are doing.
Okay, so it's not just about bringing down costs or adding value. It's also about achieving a smooth, seamless experience, quite like the Amazon shopping experience. Good point. Naveen, what are the current trends in procurement and what parts of the procurement process are you using technology today?
See, I think as Mr. Uppal have explained, you know, about the disruption, the current disruption right now in the supply chain. So I think the entire supply chain, we can see a lot of trends, disruptive trends where, you know, we are actually, you know, forced to take, to adopt or to embrace the new technologies, you know, be it in terms of data mining, be in terms of really, you know, churning out the data, the trends. So we basically in a company, we use SAP and we are contemplating a lot of new softwares, new licenses, which we are thinking because we need to enhance. We have to take this journey forward. So and digitalization is one of the enabler which can really take us to the path of good to great. So, you know, this is. Our understanding of the things, and plus we are coming from the conventional, you know, basically industry like steel, where, you know, we can use technology to do a predictive maintenance. In case the mill is not running efficiently, we can, you know, pull out the data, we can see what are the trends, you know, where the things have gone wrong, how we can improve it. So we can bring in a lot of operation excellence into play with the help of digitalization.
No, absolutely. Technology is no longer good to have, but a must have. And the pandemic has forced a lot of enterprises' hand in going digital. Ashwini, can you share your thoughts on the active role of technology in helping procurement thrive in the future to adapt itself to the new normal?
I think great thoughts have already been shared by Mr. Upal and Mr. Naveen. And few things are definitely coming out. Even if you look at the way technology is growing, or let's say the economy is going to grow. So if there's a recent report by World Bank, WEF, and SAP has done its own benchmarking, and of course the credit rating firms. If you look at the physical economy of Asia, it's expected to grow at around 8%. For the next 3 to 4 years, that's something which has been said. But if you look at the digital economy, it is expected to grow around 20 to 25%. Now that's a 3 times growth over a physical economy growth. And I think as a part of that, you would see a lot of startups have now started evolving, not only in India, but I think across Asia. So, the trends are basically getting you towards a digital era or a digital world, so to say. There was another report which I was looking at that was given by Hackett, and that has few important things which has mentioned, in terms of procurement. So if you look at a digital world-class procurement organization as compared to a typical procurement organization, that is using 25% spending less than a procurement organization and 6% less than a world-class organization. So you have now three things. You have somebody who's a procurement organization and a world-class procurement organization and a digital world-class procurement organization on top of it. And I think this is basically the beauty of technology. Of course, along with technology comes the imperatives around it. And I think we are talking about technology enablement. We are talking about data and analytics. We are talking about operating model. Looking in there, we are also talking about talent. It's very easy to say. Naveenji mentioned that probably we are looking at getting from good to great. And I think in that process, talent becomes very, very important. And that's where probably you will need to see, it is easy to probably get a technology, but it's the way you're going to implement it, it's going to be very, very important as well. So I think technology is going to play a key role when it comes to digitalizing the whole procurement experience back for them. And I think technology is getting involved, and that's where the networked economy is going to take the pace.
Okay, so workforce management is going to go hand in hand with procurement best practices as well. Sharad, Vedanta is a global company. I'm sure there are a lot of complexities which are involved when you have to manage the procurement processes across various countries. Can you talk about your procurement process? Are you already seeing a transformation in the way goods are sourced, purchased, and paid for?
Thank you, Reema. I guess the most important part, as you rightly said, Vedanta, of course, is a diversified natural resource company. And we have 7 businesses, so, and geographically located. And in terms of sourcing as well, it's pan-India and overseas as well. We import a lot of stuff. So the whole point here is, when we talk about complexity, I think technology comes as a savior. I would want to put a different perspective, or maybe simplify and decode it a little bit. So procurement, usually, if you talk about conventional procurement, it was all about buying products as we require in our operations. Now the time, there is moving to more from procurement, procuring products to procuring solutions. Solutions which are directly linked to your business outcomes and specialization. Now, how do you do that? In fact, just to give you a very relevant example, for example, we are in mining industry and we use thousands of big mining tires into our operations. Now, one would, let's say a couple of years back, one would buy tires and that's a commodity which you buy at a certain cost. Now, with time and with technology what you want to do and convert, you want to bring it to a solution which is enhancing the tire life in your mines, which takes you to the studying of compounds which will be suitable for the geotechnical areas. So the whole point is basically, how do you convert a simple buying into a solution? And that's where I think most important part, the technology helps you in by weaving the gap. The gap is basically data. Data of the product which you are buying, how does it get supplied into your operations? How does it get consumed? What impact it makes into your operation? I think so long as we have that dashboard, through technology, once it is weaved, the visibility comes. And the moment visibility comes, the solution comes. And then, of course, you know, the business houses or the service provider or the business partners, I would say, becomes very important. But they have also been, you know, working towards providing solution. That's how the industry is moving, at least as far as our industry is concerned. And then people come forward, they study the data, they look at the data through technology, and then the solutions are provided and developed over a period of time. And that's where you reduce not the cost, but the total cost of ownership and add value to your business. And that's fundamentally important to my mind in terms of structural shift. So the gap in terms of the conventional procurement and the new age procurement is basically data. And that data gets weaved through the current technology platform. You know, you can digitize your operations seamlessly. You can predict the behavior and the planning. Like, I'll give you another example of typical conventional buying in terms of, let's say, stores and spares, which is for our kind of operations or any operation for that matter, is 80% transaction and 20% value, or less than that at some point in time. Now, if you digitize that completely, we have been using SAP for 2 decades, just to tell you, our organization, and we are into SAP Ariba platform as we speak. And the whole idea is that how do we, you know, use the analytics tool, how do we create and use the new edge startups, as Ashwin mentioned. Ashwin mentioned that, you know, how do you get them to build a solution, weave a solution for you so that you don't run stores anymore. You just get just in time what you need, and the basic backend, the analytics to ensure that your plant operations are secured. You know, the entire planning, the entire data, you know, which is coming through your dashboards tells you that what would you need. And then there are technicals, there are startups, you know, who are disrupting the industry, whose core day-to-day job is to, you know, buy, for example, MRO spares. So the whole idea is tie up with them, release the bandwidth of your commercial organization, and the commercial team can work on techno-commercial initiatives to drive value, and you get a solution that releases the entire bandwidth of the organization. So that's how disruptive a technological solution, you know, can come, if you really ask me. So that's the clear part. And our objective as Vedanta is that how do we create that disruption? And we create touchless buying, actually, completely touchless buying. And we don't buy products, we buy solutions.
Interesting. Mansoor, could you share your thoughts on this topic? And if you have any examples in which you could share how digitization has impacted your business in value terms?
Yeah, absolutely. So basically, in Reckitt, we believe, you know, digitization is one of the core areas we need to invest in and wherein, you know, we get, you know, maximum value out of it. So we are using, you know, different platforms in procurement, the electronic platform. For example, you talked about Ariba, wherein, you know, we can bring down, you know, the value, you know, more transparency, you know, more compliance and all of that. And Reckitt, you know, our core value, you know, our core compass is, you know, that do the right things always, you know, it goes with that, you know, bringing all the things. Then, you know, there is a data analytics tools we are using to derive the data, you know, taking, you know, the understanding the highest spend, which, you know, we are, you know, doing in what areas, you know, we are doing that through, you know, a digital tool, you know, the SRM, you know, we are doing, you know, a lot of things, you know, on a digitization platforms, wherein, you know, we can find out, you know, how you know, procurement can be a growth enabler to the organization. Because, you know, as one of the, you know, members said, you know, procurement is you know, looking at just as a, you know, cost saving function. We have to, you know, think well level up as a business partner, then only, you know, we can drive, you know, growth in the organization.
Okay, so it's not just a cost saver, but a growth enabler, and it's all about joining the dots using data. Ashwini, a lot of the, you know, companies are using SAP solutions, and solutions is now clearly the way to go. Could you share, you know, some examples of your solutions with your clients and how they resulted in tangible outcomes in bringing down costs or bringing down cycle time reductions?
No, yeah, absolutely. And I think very happy to see, you know, the way Sharad mentioned about SAP Ariba, for sure. I have been into procurement for such a long time now. And in fact, my entire career is around supply chain. And you know, the good part is we don't call it supply chain now. You know, it's a supply network, I would say. You know, for example, you know, every one of us who's there on the system right now, we all have a problem. Let's say there's a machine under breakdown. Now, it's very easy to say, you know, the machine went under breakdown and I can get into the system and I can look for a person, you know, who can probably come in and sort this out. What if I do not know who is the person from an OEM perspective who's going to come in and actually sort this out for me? What if I do not know where is the manual for this? What if I do not know, you know, how to actually sort this out for me? Because it's a small problem probably, but I don't have the ready-made solution to it. Now, do I have something which is like an asset intelligence network in place where I'm connected seamlessly through my all my OEMs, you know, for all my machinery? And that's where I basically, you know, pick up a request in the system and the system shows me a glossary of all the problems. And probably I'm getting connected to the OEM straight away within a span of 10 seconds to probably understand, you know, who probably can come from his side and actually look at the machine. On the other hand, if it is very easy to say, you know, if somebody calls from a procurement, where's my material? And this person might say, you know what, it left my warehouse this morning and it's going to be in your office or in your warehouse or let's say in your shop floor by the end of the day. But then how do I know where it is right now? You know, maybe it's stuck or maybe unfortunately met with an accident. Do I have a logistics business network which can do track and trace? And I think, you know, those are the kind of technologies which are also coming out, probably to add certain more reflection to it. Some of the companies are also talking, they're saying why an accounts payable function is a function which spends money. Why can't it be a profit center? You know, can I generate as an accounts payable department savings for my organization? And not only savings, but probably have a better terms negotiated with my suppliers, basically to pass on that benefit to my organization. And I think this is where the technology is ready. A lot of companies have been using it. The benefits are getting reaped. And I think some of the companies or the panelists are already a customer, you know, to SAP Ariba, and some of the companies are probably getting onto it. And that's where, you know, we have seen that in not only in terms of savings, but I think in cycle time reduction. And I think, you know, Mr. Upal mentioned in the beginning, like an Amazon-like experience, you know, I order something in my house, it's there in next 2 days. But when I order it in my organization, it takes 2 weeks. Why is that the case? Or let's say the touchless process, which Sharad was also talking about, you know, so I think, you know, the whole idea is it's not only about cost saving now, value proposition is becoming important. And I think with the help of data, the visibility, what we are trying to get in, the technology is there to actually take you to the next level. So it's totally beyond cost savings now. We are talking about cycle time reduction, making it easy, supplier experience, user experience. Those are becoming important imperatives, I would say, in the world today in terms of procurement.
Rajesh, the pandemic threw up a lot of imbalances in supply and demand. Can you talk about what your learnings were and how did it force Maruti to reimagine its sourcing and procurement process?
One big learning from pandemic has been, you know, the your ability to manage risks, you know, how proactively you can manage the whole risk, and you be an agile organization to change the way you work and change the way you operate. So the whole focus on being risk management is a critical part where you have a multiple sourcing or multiple routing available. So all the you know, options possible, can you deliberate that through in the beginning and keep that handy? Then the problem comes in all, because the uncertainty and the you know, the whole environment which is unpredictable, I think throwing a lot of challenges to all of us. So as an organization, if you can be agile in your systems and processes, and also you have a very strong risk management practice, I think this is the two key learnings to really manage the whole supply chain.
Sharad, if you could share your learnings. And, you know, when a company says they're agile, they've got a future-ready supply chain, what exactly does it mean? How would it compare with, say, what it was 10 years ago?
So I think the most important part, it again boils down to the right planning, the right understanding, and multiplicity of, or keeping the alternatives ready, I would say. The multiplicity of options always in hand, and also alternate product. Try and bring another interesting thought which has come, and I'm sure it's applicable to other businesses. How do you bring your partners closer? Let's say downstream integration. See how can you get solutions very closer to your operations to de-risk your operations. How do we use alternate means of getting our product on time, and how do we manage? So it's all about you know, getting it, your system gets tested, your robustness of system actually was put to test, I would say. And then the most important part is, you know, how do you innovate during the time of difficulties? I think that's what, to my mind, pandemic has taught us all. And we have all become more resilient, more adaptive to change, and the technology adoption, you know, procurement being a very conventionally managed and very, you know, we used to call it department. Now it's more about business partnering and how agile, how innovative are we in terms of finding the right solutions. That's what pandemic has taught us. And technology adoption, I would say, if the rate was, let's say, 10% or 15% year on year in terms of technology adoption and procurement, my guess and what we are trying to do in Vedanta is we are trying to do it 100%. Complete transformation of the procurement function. And the mindset, what pandemic has done is that has brought the mindset change amongst all of us, all the professionals who sometimes used to think that, you know, that we will do it. There is little merit in doing it. So I guess that's the real crux, you know, if you ask me. And another important fundamental aspect, I would say, you know, which keeps coming in, Ashwini also mentioned, is that how do you look at your procurement function? With technology, I would say it has to be faceless, touchless, contactless. And my experience says that not less than 50% of the time, you know, goes in conversations, goes in follow-ups, goes in various discussions, which are nothing but transactional. I think once you save that time to technology, that goes into value addition and business partnering, where you can run techno-commercial initiatives and add immense value to your business.
Naveen, you know, the question now is, what will be the role of procurement in the new normal? From here on, how do you accelerate?
Yeah, see, Rima, you know, Ashwini has mentioned, see, we have seen the disruption. The conventional way of procurement was definitely, you know, put under a lot of stress and stretch in these times. So I think from here on, a lot of things are going to, you know, we have to focus as the professionals. We have to focus on so many new things, which was never tried, you know, in past. First is about, you know, the increased focus, or you have to improve the, you know, supplier relationship management. That is so, you know, such a great key enabler in the entire process. Second, you have to bring all your supplier partners near to your manufacturing location. So basically, more or less, you know, companies like, you know, steel companies or other companies, they have to basically migrate their process to our Toyota production system. So which our automotive or FMCG companies, they normally do, you know. And third point is basically, you know, the human capital, what Ashwini mentioned, it is a very important point, because you also need that capital to the human capital to really, you know, basically develop to bring in the intelligence and to unlock the their critical, you know, basically time, so that they can invest more time in critical thinking. Because lot of you know, post order issues are there, the conventional normal mundane work is there. With the help of technology, I think that is what, wherein we can unleash the timing of the critical resources, so that they can think more critically, they can do more critical thinking and invest their time in bringing more operation excellence with the help of techno-commercial things. Then the last point is basically about you know, how the entire Europe, you know, evaluation of your supplier partners, localizing, vocal for local, what our honorable prime minister always talk about. This is an amazing opportunity, because we believe that this crisis brings a lot of opportunities, new things, and this is the area I think where we can sort of build in that system where we have new supplier partners. You know, you develop those supplier partners, then you make your supply chain in such a way that you are not dependent on so many unknowns. Because every week we are facing those unknowns. It is not that pandemic has gone and you know, all the issues have been stopped. Still, on daily basis, there is some coal issue in China. There are some, you know, the entire shipping industry has taken a toll, you know, in terms of the cost of the ships and freight forwarders. So every day we are, and China, you know, where in our industry, steel industry, where they control 55% of the global capacity. Even if they sneezes, everybody, you know, catches cold. So it is so very important that we have to basically bring in or develop the ecosystem in our country, so that, you know, it become independent of the external, you know, sort of test. so that the external environment has the least impact on the overall ecosystem. So that is where I think I see a trend going forward, wherein so much of investment is there in terms of supplier partners. Gone are the days where, you know, there was a tendency to going, you know, to bring in the imported material or maybe to partner with someone abroad. But now I think so much of focus has been there, where we invest our time with them in terms of, you know, to develop them, even if they need financing, even if they need financial support, in that, you know, if they need the infrastructure development. So I think we are coming forward and investing our time, efforts to grow this ecosystem. That is so very important. If you don't grow this ecosystem, you are again going to face the same issues which we faced during COVID.
Ashwini, which gets us back to the point about this being a network, value being delivered through innovation and a networked function. Can you talk about how from here on companies should be leveraging technology?
Yeah, and I think Naveen hit the right point. You know, with so much happening for vocal for local, you know, like the way we call it as, I think the suppliers also need to pick up their game. And it is again becoming very important that digital literacy reaches everywhere, you know. So to your point, and I think Naveen did hit a very important point around resilience, and then sustainability right on top of it, you know, is becoming a board topic now, you know. So everybody would like to understand how sustainable my ecosystem is. For example, I'm working with one particular supplier right now, and he could be the top supplier right now in let's say India, but then you don't even know, maybe he's going to file a bankruptcy in US. And I think that's going to bring a lot of trouble back in India, and your whole supply chain can be under danger as well. So is there a way to proactively know, you know, what kind of supplier risk are we looking at, and then stop the obvious from, you know, to happen basically. So I think the networked economy, and I think the information, the data around the networked economy is going to become very, very important. And I think this is what every company is trying to drive now as a topic. Very, very important in today's world, and that's where I think a lot of discussions are taking place as well. Now, of course, you know, since I come from SAP, SAP has those kind of products which can probably help you in order to understand if proactively you can find out if your supply chain is under danger or risk, you know, whether it is financial or environmental or you know, a lot of things are happening. Say, Naveen did mention about if there is a problem in China, we have a problem. But and we saw that Suez Canal thing happen. So that's like a natural catastrophe, I can put it as, which is man-made, I would say. But then do we have the signals at the right time to say the Suez Canal is going to be blocked? If you have material coming in from there, 2 weeks, bye-bye, you're not going to have anything actually out there. So I think those are the kind of things which are becoming important. Sustainability is going to be at the top of it. And I think supply chain network itself, you know, I would say it's not a chain anymore, it's a supply network itself, is going to play a very crucial role.
Absolutely. I think disruptions are just becoming ever so common nowadays. But how easy, you know, Mansoor, according to you, is to get this data? You know, Ashwini spoke about what if, you know, a supplier is likely to file for bankruptcy. If you get some hints about it before, perhaps we could make alternate arrangements. But how easy is it to get this data? And what are the other roadblocks, according to you, in this digital transformation?
So there are solutions, you know, which provide you, you know, these data. You know, they give you the ratings like, you know, green, amber, and red. You know, I don't want to name that organization which provide these kind of solution, but there are solutions in place. There are you know, companies which gives you these details, you know, and at a global level, if there is any media disruption or is there any bankruptcy filed by any company, they can give you that data. So these things are available with you, but you know how, you know, you have to, you know, approach that, you know, company to get that data. And as Ashwini said, it is very important to know to the procurement manager that, you know, whom he is dealing with, you know, how competent that vendor is and that vendor partner is. And digitization, you know, plays a very important role in terms of, you know, giving that data to you, you know. And one of our team member, you know, mentioned about, you know, the innovation, you know, the shared success. And we at Reckitt, you know, our core value is we build, you know, shared success. And we believe that, you know, we achieve more when we are trusted partners, you know. So that is a very important, you know, enabler to bridge the gap between, you know, the supplier and the, you know, procurement manager and the company.
Sharad, can artificial intelligence be used for this? Mansoor said in some form of fashion data is available, but even if it's color coded, the procurement process, can it be automated? And according to you, which tasks can be taken over by AI in the future?
See, there are two parts, I would say. I would start with AI. And, you know, now you have digital dashboards wherein and the systems through AI has capability to pick up the news bytes which are relevant. You know, you can always connect to a network of plethora of websites, information sites, you know, trade association, what do you call it? For example, supply chain, the logistics bulletins. And the idea is to put the keywords, get the search right, and get what you need. So any kind of regulatory change, any kind of supply chain disruption, any kind of geographical issues. So all that, you know, can come to you on your dashboard through digital. So the relevant experience, you know, based on your customer information, based on your suppliers information, you know, you can always do that. And that's why AI plays a big role. Second part is the predictability of the system, I would say. You know, predictability, if you have your entire operation and maintenance digitally tracked, if your digital tools and algorithms can do predictive maintenance analysis, you can always plan your requirement ahead of the curve. And I think that's where, to my mind, technology plays a big role. Coming to procure-to-pay process, which typically is the procurement process we say, I think to my mind, it starts right from the RFQ stage till the procurement stage and delivered stage. Everywhere technology can play a role. And, you know, we talked about Amazon-like experience. You know, a few years back, how many of us would have been, you know, talking about Alexa or Siri's of the world? You know, now all of us have got used to it. And that's where I think the whole idea about technology, and when I say faceless, that's what it really means, that if we get used to getting those informations, getting exceptions sounded in terms of voice alerts to us or systems, you know, management by exception comes through these algorithms, I think that would be a game changer. And that's what is happening. That's where the world is driving to, I would believe.
Ashwini, your thoughts on which procurement tasks can be taken over by artificial intelligence in the future?
No, it's a very, very interesting topic. And I think Sharad mentioned a lot of things, and like he said, every facet of it has a lot of things probably which can be done, and artificial intelligence can play its role. So if you look at it, and I think, you know, there are technologies which are coming up, and I think to Mansoor's point as well, there are a lot of companies probably on the rating side of it which probably can give you a lot of data, whether it is green, red, amber, or whether it is looking at even some sort of a scorecard, you know, in terms of sustainability or companies who are also looking at, let's say, the environmental responsibility as one of the things. But then you need to scale the solution. And I think that's where AI is going to play a role. So if I just pick up on top of that example, it is very easy to get data across big companies, you know, big suppliers, you know. But when it comes to very small companies who probably are very local to you inside a particular country, that's where a lot of these rating agencies would suffer. And that's where we get AI into picture. We do web crawling, you know, around 800,000 resources are going to be looked at. And AI is going to play a part in machine learning, etc. The moment there is a threat out there in terms of, let's say, ratings coming out from these agencies, or let's say, even if they go in a website, or let's say a government portal, or even if it is in the public domain, these crawlers are going to go in and then get you a lot of data insights in terms of having a risk scorecard generated from various facets of actually looking at risk, whether it is environmental or reputational or financial, you know, we are looking at from an organization standpoint, etc. And I think, you know, that's where AI is going to play a lot of role. And, you know, mundane works, and I think this is what everybody basically mentioned, mundane works, AI is going to be very, very, the tasks are very repetitive in nature. That's where AI is going to get in definitely and pick up those certain threads. And if we can, you know, let's say automate these kind of things, make them touchless, faceless, you know, like the way Sharad was saying, I think that's going to save a lot of time and energy and investment for the companies out there. And probably you can, you know, get that strategic thing or thinking going on in your procurement organization. So AI will have a lot to do in the coming years. And there are certain areas which are already marked. And I think, like the panelists said, things have already started moving on the AI. In fact, SAP has done a lot of AI enablement in its own products as well. And that's a treat to watch, I would say.
Naveen, Rajesh already spoke about customer-centric procurement. Can you talk about how that is being transformed?
See, at the end of the day, the procurement, you know, what it brings in that value. At the end of the day, the goal is basically to ensure that the customer, we have a satisfied customer. So I think with so much of dynamism into play, with wherein, you know, we see different orders coming in and the, you know, the availability of the material, there's a huge issue in terms of the metal availability. So I think every day a lot of challenges you face from the customers. So because of their demand, because of their requirement, and so many other things, different grades, different SKUs. So the entire thing, I think, then the procurement department comes into a picture wherein, you know, they have to make all these plannings, and with this so much of dynamism, and then all these values, you know, creation like vendor managed inventories, the long term contracts, and the, you know, evaluating the things on total cost of ownership, working very closely with your supplier partners, that come into picture. So I think customer definitely is at the key. That is what I think everybody is doing it. And they, there was so much of focus on the customer things. But I think now there has to be a tectonic shift. Customer is definitely the key. But then now, as I said earlier, also the supplier relationship management will hold a key in driving this process moving forward. And the second one is digitalization, definitely, because, you know, we have this because measurement drives the behavior, and your behavior drives the culture of the company. And measurement, you know, how digitalization is going to help is to get this all this data analysis. And, you know, with so much of AI, we have just spoken on the AI also, you know, you get the trend. Okay, this machine, this, you know, sourcing, this much of requirement you had earlier. Now you are moving from it. And this was a, you know, peak you have seen. So please beware of that peak. When the commodity prices have hit high, this is how the normal trend of sourcing, strategic sourcing you have. So all these trends are very much available. And it is, I think, we have to just, I think, embrace this technology. I think it will make, you know, as Sharad explained, I think 15 to 20% value generation it can easily have. And not about the value creation. I think the number of hours, man hours you unleash from this, because the mundane transactional work, it is so difficult. 60-70% of the time it just goes on follow-up with the transporter, follow-up with the supplier. So if we can cut all those things, then I think so much of time can be invested in value creation.
Okay, on that note, we're going to wrap up this discussion. It's been extremely enriching. I think across the world now, companies have recognized the power of procurement, flexible workforces to achieve cost savings, to bring in agility, and more importantly, reduce risk in a world where supply and demand, as we know, has become increasingly volatile. So truly, today, procurement has assumed strategic operational significance. Thank you, gentlemen, once again, Rajesh, Sharad, Naveen, Mr. Ashwini. Thank you for joining in, as well as Mr. Mansoor.